أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد صلى الله عليه محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرباح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And congratulations on the auspicious occasion of the birth anniversary of the last messenger, the seal of the messengers of the Almighty God, which in the coming days we will be celebrating. And also congratulations to our present Imam, Imam al-Hujjah Jalallah Farjuh Sharif, on behalf of all of us, on a suspicious coincidence with the birth anniversary of the sixth Imam of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi afdalu salawat wa tahiyyat. Alhamdulillahi alladhi hadana lihada wa ma kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah. As Brother Saeed kindly mentioned, this is the fourth session and the last session that we have on this topic in series of talks on state and religion. We've come a long way, and inshallah, by the grace of God, we have to conclude it tonight, although the discussion still is open. And as I had said it right from the beginning, such a comprehensive topic is almost impossible in its own details to cover it in four sessions, but alhamdulillah, we've come a long way. To quickly recap, as brother mentioned that some of you haven't been with us, although always the tapes are available and you can inshallah listen and watch them. We've been talking about the state and religion, whether they are compatible and incompatible. Initially, we presented the topic in two sessions, and then due to the question and answers and the demand of you brothers and sisters, we thought we continue and added two more sessions to it to look at the other side of it. Mainly the first two sessions we're talking about the evidences we have to support the idea, the belief that, as we said, Islam and state, not only they are compatible, they're rather interwoven, that we cannot separate them from one another. And we supported it with ample evidences. In the last session, which was the previous one, the third one, we look at the other side of it, study the evidences that a very minor, though, group of Muslims suggesting that during the time of major occultation, apparently it is not permissible to establish any Islamic state, because the criterion for heading an Islamic state, according to what they say, is infallibility, al-isma, not a mere justice. We dealt with that. Tonight, by the grace of God, we are going to cover the last two most important issues that really the actual topics in the topic of Wilayat al-Faqih among our scholars has been the first part of what we are going to talk about it mainly tonight. So the topic for tonight consists of two parts. The first part of it is talking about absolute or limited power or authority of a jurist. We are going to examine and see whether Wali Faqih, qualified jurist, is he supposed to have an absolute authority and power, or his authority should be limited to certain areas, as we'll define the topic completely inshallah, and we'll cover it. And the second part of the lecture for tonight, we'll be also talking about again an internal discussion between those who, although they all agree that a qualified jurist has and must have an absolute authority, but there is a discussion between them that is this absolute authority given to one single jurist or should be given to the council of jurists? Are we talking about Wali al-Faqih or Wali al-Fuqaha or Shawr al-Maraji? The Council of Maraji must be running the state. Inshallah, tonight we'll be dealing with both of them, with Salawat ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammad. Now, as for the first one, the topic of whether a jurist must have a limited authority or absolute authority. When we are talking about absolute authority, that in my other literatures I've suggested to make sure that the general public understand and there's no misconception, we are talking about a general authority of a jurist. By general or absolute, we mean in various areas. Let me list the main seven areas that we are talking about the authority of a jurist, that according to evidences that we have, the ayat and the rawayat, jurists would have authority and power in those areas. The first five that I'm going to mention are the one that, at least in the recent centuries, our jurists are quite unanimous about it. By and large, they all agree on them. The first one is in issuing a fatwa on jurisprudential matters. Today, the books of practical laws of Islam that we have, Tawzih al-Masail or Rasala Amaliyah of your marja, is an example of that. All our jurists are unanimous that unless a faqih, a jurist, would have an authority from Imam al-Hujjah Jalallahu Farajahu Sharif, he would not issue his book of Risala Amaliyah to give fatwa on an issue. Otherwise, what would oblige me to accept and listen to what my marja tells me in terms of tahara, praying, fasting, etc., in other all aspects of jurisprudence. So the first area that there is no dispute about it is that yes, a qualified jurist would have authority on giving a fatwa on practical laws of Islam. The second issue that again there is no dispute about it is on judicial matters. When it comes to a dispute between two people or more than two, we have ample evidences to support this, that we are not allowed to go to non-jurists because they are regarded as tyrants. Yes, unless you are living somewhere that in order for you to obtain your right and your haq, there is no any other option available to you rather than going to a civil court. Otherwise, as long as there is a qualified jurist available, we have to go to him. And he is the one who has the authority to judge. So the second is on judicial matters. The third is in caring over the well-being of vulnerable members of Muslim society, like like orphans, widows, insane, and any as such that they don't have any specific guardian. A qualified jurist by Imam Mahdi, as representative of Imam Mahdi, has the authority to look after the well-being of orphans, widows, and such people in the society, in the community, that there is no specific guardian for them. They have to look after their well-being. So this is the third. Again, there is no dispute about the authority of a qualified jurist on it. The fourth that again, by and large, there is no dispute about it, is in collecting homes, zakat, any type of charity and things like that, collecting it from people and distributing it to where it has to be distributed, to the poor and needy people and whoever who is the recipient of such Islamic taxation money. So again, unless my marja would have the authority to collect my wealth, on which basis would I give my homes to him? So he must have an authority as the representative of Imam al-Mahdi al-Jalallahu Farajahu Sharif to collect homes, zakat, and such things, what do you call it, from me. This is four. The fifth one, again, jurists are unanimous that a qualified jurist has the authority in solemnizing a marriage as well as dissoluting a marriage. Let's say there is a young girl who wants to get married, a virgin girl, and her father is either absent or is being unreasonable, adamant against a marriage that is for her best interest with someone with whom she is very compatible. But her father doesn't let her marry the compatible person. A qualified jurist has the authority to marry her to her compatible guy, the person who wants to has asked for her hand, whether her father agrees or not, or whether her father is around or not. At the same time, a lady who is in a very desperate situation and really her marriage has to be ended in divorce, again, a qualified jurist has the authority to end that marriage in the case that her husband is either away and absent and there is no knowledge, no access to him at all, or again he's being very unreasonable that he under no circumstances would accept to divorce her. On these five areas, our jurists are unanimous that a qualified jurist has the authority. There are two more that are matters of dispute, and there are some who agree and some who disagree. I would tell you that still majority of our jurists would agree on these two as well, but there are some who disagree based on the evidences. So the sixth one is in executing Islamic criminal laws, lashing, sentencing criminals to death and things like that. Fiskan penalty, al-hudud, qisas, wal-diyat. Not all our jurists are unanimous that a jurist has the authority to lash, let's say, someone who's been drinking alcohol, or what do you call it, someone who's committed adultery, or things like that. Some they say that we do not have the authority from Imam Mahdi to execute the criminal laws of Islam. The last one is in governing a state. Again, this is a matter of dispute, whether a qualified jurist has the authority as representative of Imam Mahdi to supervise and oversee and to run a state during the time of major occultation or not. Those who believe in absolute authority of a qualified jurist are those who say that in all these seven areas, a jurist has the authority. Those who say that a qualified jurist has limited authority, that means that in these seven areas, in one, two, mainly, or even perhaps rarely, though more than two, they say that his authority, for example, is limited to the first two, to the first three, to four, to five, and the five is quite unanimous about it. So this is the meaning of limited or absolute authority that we are talking about. So by definition, please remember this is a very important part of our discussion. When we are talking about wilayat al-mutlaqa lil-faqih, the absolute authority of a jurist, we are talking about any kind of right and authority that an infallible enjoys in running an Islamic state. Those who believe in absolute authority, they say that any right and authority that Imam al-Ma'soom, an infallible Imam, would have to run a state, a Wali Faqih also would enjoy the same right and authority in running an state. Later on, inshallah, I will clarify a misconception that by absolute authority, we don't mean that he's free from the law and he can do as he wishes. No, it means that to run an estate, he has the full authority to run an Islamic estate for the best Islamic interest. Okay? Now that we know what we mean by absolute authority, let's tonight look at the other side of it, and that is look at the opinion of some of the opponents to absolute authority of qualified jurists. Again, now we know that by that means that in certain areas they disagree that a jurist would have authority. Mainly the controversial issue is when it comes to running a state, that they say that a qualified, we don't have any textual evidences to prove it to us that a jurist would have authority on that. Sheikh Murtada al-Ansari, rahmatullah alayhi, one of the very eminent and renowned fuqaha who died more than 150 years ago, is one of the very well-known figures to that. Unlike his teacher, Mullah Ahmad al-Naraqi, who was one of the main supporters of absolute authority of faqih, Sheikh Murtada al-Ansari, he goes against the teacher in this discussion, and he says that, and I quote, that to provide any evidences on the obligation of obeying a jurist is the same way as that of the in the same way as that of the Prophet and the Imams alayhimu salam. This is only possible when pigs fly. This is my translation. Sheikh Murtada Ansari, in his book of Al-Makasib, he uses the expression that دُونَهُ خَرْطُ الْقَتَادِ. خَرْطُ الْقَتَادِ is an expression in Arabic that, if I want to openly translate it, I would say that he says that to provide evidences for absolute authority of a faqih is possible when pigs fly. We know in English pigs don't fly, therefore this is not possible. In other words, he's trying to say that to provide any textual evidence for that, it's not possible. And then he goes to some of the riwayat that he suggested to support that and challenges the authenticity or the meaning of all those, evidences and riwayat. Despite this, Rahmatullah alayhi Sheikh Murtada al-Ansari, in his book of Al-Qadha wa Shahadat, when he's talking about judgment and testimonies when it comes to judicial matters, as well as when it comes to the issue of Khums, he believes in absolute authority of qualified jurists, that a jurist would have absolute authority to collect the Khums and distribute it. And especially when he is giving a fatwa on something, because then it becomes obligatory upon his followers to follow his ruling. So unless he has the authority on the issue of homes, on the issue of judicial matters, otherwise, what is the point of giving any fatwa? Another figure, famous figure, one of the contemporaries who died a couple of decades ago, Rahmatullah alayhi, the late Ayatollah Sayyid Abu al-Qasim al-Khoi rahmatullah alayhi, that I believe many of you, perhaps all of you know him, one of the contemporary maraji. Ayatollah Khoi also, in one of his Buhuth al-Kharij that was compiled by one of his students as tanqih, he states also that, and I quote, the narrations related to the topic, meaning to the topic of Wilayat al-Mutlaqah, the absolute authority of a jurist, are insufficient. I repeat again, he says the narrations related to the topic are insufficient, both in terms of their textual meaning and their authenticity. Insufficient in what? To provide the absolute authority of a jurist in other than fatwa and judgment. So according to this statement of Sayyid Abu al-Qasim al-Khoi rahmatullah alayhi, he says that the absolute authority of jurists based on riwayat and narrations can be only proven to prove that he has the right to give fatwa and he has the right to give his judgment in judicial matters. In more than that, we don't have enough evidences that either their sanad, authenticity of the riwayat, or the meaning are sufficient and good enough. Despite this, Ayatollah Khoi rahmatullah alayhi, this is something that I want inshallah tonight to clarify and say that although in some of his literature Ayatollah Khoi seems to be against the absolute authority of a jurist, especially when it comes in running a state, but in some other literature you see that he is inclining towards this a lot. I deliberately have quoted something and I read it to you, although the text is a little bit long, because it's very important and something that really we are usually not privy to it. The late Ayatollah Khoi, in another literature of himself, when he's talking about the authority of a jurist in executing the criminal laws. Remember I told you that in criminal laws, not all our jurists are unanimous. Ayatollah Khoi wants to prove that in criminal laws, yes, a jurist also has the authority to execute the criminal laws of Islam. Look at what he says, and I quote, executing the laws of punishment is for the well-being of the Muslim society to avoid any corruption or criminal act. The well-being cannot be limited to a specific period of time. So His Eminence says that the well-being of the Muslim society, the security of Muslim society, is not only to the time of the Prophet and the Imams.
Because if the criminal law is not executed, then there is no security for the rest of the nation. What is a specific period of time? He says the time of presence of an infallible ma'sumin. For this benefit is not due to the presence of an infallible. The security of Muslims is not, and the maslaha and the benefit for that is not just for when ma'sum is around. Okay? Rather, the divine wisdom necessitated that people's well-being shall be always looked after. The divine wisdom necessitates that people's well-being shall be at all times be looked after. Then he concludes, therefore, the criminal laws must always be executed in order for security of the country to be maintained. Yes. There is no clear evidence. Please follow me in what he says. He goes, there is no clear evidence. By evidence, he's talking about riwayat. No clear evidence to indicate who shall be in charge of executing these criminal laws. However, and I've highlighted this here deliberately, however, it is a common sense that laymen are not responsible for it. In the expression of fuqaha, laymen al-awam here is an expression for anyone who is not a qualified jurist. Even if the person has degrees on political sciences but does not have the jurisprudential knowledge, here is regarded as a layman who does not know qadha al-islam, does not know fiqh al-islam, does not know how to judge Islamically, the Islamic rules and laws, he doesn't know. He says that the common sense dictates that God could not have left it to laymen, to anyone who is nominating himself and is voted to be all of the sudden the head of the state and the president or the judge and things like that. Or it will cause an anarchy. He says that if we say that God has left it to the general public, it would cause an anarchy, because a person who is sitting in the position of a judge and doesn't have the qualification for judgment. Besides, he continues, the holy Imam Ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif in his holy letter states, وَأَمَّا الْحَوَادِثُ الْوَاقِعَةِ فَرْجِعُوا فِيهَا لَرُوَاتَ أَحَادِيثَنَا. In the coming matters, go to those who narrate our ahadith, understand our ahadith, and we say that this is an expression for our fuqaha today, فَإِنَّهُمْ حُجَّتِي عَلَيْكُمْ وَأَنَا حُجَّةُ اللَّهِ. They are the evidences for you, proofs on you, as I am the proof and evidence on them, on what they say. Then he concludes, therefore, such narrations supported by evidences indicating that the right of judgment belongs to Muslim jurists, such narrations vividly demonstrate that execution of criminal laws and all such disciplinary laws is the right and the duty of jurists. End of quotation. Now, clearly, based on what His Eminence states in Mabani Takmilatul Minhaj, he is trying to prove that the position of judgment and executing Islamic criminal laws is the duty of a qualified jurist. Humbly, here we only have one question, and that is, Sayyidina al-Aziz, in Iraq today, in Afghanistan today, in Pakistan today, you find me a qualified marja, and there are maraji, who has the authority and can exercise his authority to judge Islamically, to sentence someone to death, to sentence a criminal, someone who's committed adultery, to be lashed 100 times and so forth, to give an Islamic judgment. Which one of our respected maraji in today's Iraq, Afghanistan, Pakistan, or such countries, they have permission to do so? So if I have to judge and get the position of judgment, unless there is an Islamic state, otherwise who gives me the authority to exercise my authority? So if we want to accept, and if we agree that the jurist has the authority from Imam Mahdi to be a judge, this can only happen, the well-being of society that you're talking about can only happen under the shadow of an Islamic state. that there is a qualified jurist on the top, then he can appoint a judge, a supreme in the court and other places. In all fairness to Ayatollah Khoi Rahmatullah Alayh, in his Risala Amaliyyah in Arabic, that is comprehensive Risala Amaliyyah, that is called Minhaj al-Salihin, and he has compiled it one and a half years, less than 2 years before he passes away, Rahmatullah Alayh. Look at what he says. There is, I need to quickly detour here and I'll tell you that there is a discussion among our jurists that during the time of major occultation, like our time, is it possible for a faqih, does he have the authority to call for jihad al-ibtidai, initial jihad, against the kuffar or not? Majority, they say no. Jihad al-ibtidai in the time of major occultation is not permissible. There is a minority like Sahib al-Jawahir that they say that no, it's possible. If necessary, it's possible. But needs the permission of a qualified jurist. Ayatollah Khoi here goes against Mashhur stands by Sahib al-Jawahir in his last literature, and look at what he says. He says the legitimacy of initial jihad during the era of major occultation depends on the permission of a qualified jurist. So if a qualified jurist gives the permission to go for jihad, it is legitimate. Unless this qualified jurist is Wali al-Faqih, the head of the state, otherwise would the president of Iraq, Afghanistan, or any of such countries, would they allow this marja to give fatwa for jihad, for example? Of course not. All right. صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد اللهم صل على اللهم صل على محمد. Now, in a nutshell, I want to comment on the opinion of those who seem to be against the absolute authority of Wali al-Faqih. Let's say, worse come to worse, if really that's what they meant, Sheikh al-Ansari, Sheikh al-Naini, Ayatollah Khoi, if we agree that these people, yes, they believe that there is no evidences to support the authority of faqih in running a state. First comment that we have, friends, difference of opinion is one of the advantages of the Shia. Huh? This is not the first time that our jurists are disagreeing on a matter. From beginning of fiqh to the end of it, there are numbers of issues that they disagree on, based on their istinbatat and the deduction and the understanding of the evidences. So be it. So this being one of them, what's the big deal about it? Majority of our, at least absolute majority of our current maraji, they agree with the absolute authority of Wali al-Faqih. There is a minority, let's say, that they disagree. So be it. That's their understanding. This is the hujjah between them and God, and those, they have a hujjah between them and God as well. This is one. The second, in understanding the opinion of any mujtahid, any faqih, any jurist, whether past or present, we have to consider the time and place of their residence, because it plays a great role in giving their fatwa. It is possible that the late Ayatollah Khoi, when he was delivering his public lectures in Najaf al-Ashraf, he was remembered under the severe tyranny of Saddam al-La'in. Perhaps he would not have the freedom to express himself freely. In the last literature, 1.5 years before he passes away in Minhaj al-Salihin, look at what he says. He is even accepting Jihad al-Ibtida'i as the authority of jurists. So we are not really too sure that he was definitely against it. It is possible that he did not feel comfortable to express himself clearly. Example that I have for you, Muhaqqiq Thani, that I mentioned perhaps in the second session that we had, Muhaqqiq al-Karaki, he was living at the time of Safavid dynasty. All right, the king of his time invited him all the way from Jabal Amel, from Lebanon, to come to Iran and be like a wali, similar to Wali Faqih, and he publicly announced that actually the state is in the hand of, and should be in the hand of, Muhaqqiq Karaki, as the representative of Imam al-Hujjah. That's why you see Muhaqqiq al-Karaki clearly, openly in his literatures, he talks about absolute authority of Wali al-Faqih. Perhaps Muhaqqiq al-Karaki also, if he was under different circumstances, he would have a different expression mentioned. And the third is that the absolute authority of a qualified jurist is a matter of common sense. Ayatollah Khoui, and I quoted him, he also mentioned it's a matter of common sense, meaning that let's say that there is no hadith. There is no hadith to support that. Let's say someone like Ayatollah Khoui, whose style is to be very particular in challenging the authenticity of narrations, let's say none of them pass authentication, still it's a matter of common sense for the well-being of Muslim society to have the head of their state a most qualified, just jurist. The late Ayatollah Burujerdi has an expression that if you help me with salawat, inshallah I'll share it with you. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. The late Ayatollah al-Uzma Burujerdi, he says that even if the textual evidences are insufficient, as Sheikh al-Ansari was saying, we can still prove the concept of the absolute authority of a qualified jurist by rational reasoning, okay? Ayatollah Bahjad Rahmatullah Alayhi presented in a more details. He says that during the era of major occultation, we are left with three options only as for the head of the state. Number one, we say that the first option possibly would be to say suspension of the Book of Allah and the laws of Islam. All Islamic laws, especially when it comes to executing the criminal laws, must be suspended during the major occultation. The second possible option would be to say, I'm quoting Ayatollah Bahjad, the second option would be to say that the Book of Allah must execute its own laws. It doesn't need any executor. Hasbuna kitab Allah. And the third option is that no, the Book of Allah, Quran, and the laws of Islam need executor. Ayatollah Bahjah says that obviously the first two options are out. To say that the laws of Islam must be suspended is nonsense, because Islam was not only for the time of the Prophet and the Imams. And the second, to say that the laws of Islam doesn't need any executor, is nonsense. Therefore, it's void. Why? Because any book of law needs an executor. Any constitution needs an executor. So we are left only with the third option. The question therefore here is that who shall be the executor of the Islamic laws during the time of major occultation? And Ayatollah Bahjad concludes that it's a matter of common sense. Anyone who has tasted the riwayat and the Islamic faith would immediately come to the conclusion that none other than a just qualified jurist would have this authority. And that is the end of the story about this. One clarification here, and inshallah, quickly we proceed to the next one. Thank you for your patience tonight, inshallah. I hope that I won't keep you long, but because we want to finish it, inshallah, tonight, it may take a little bit longer. The clarification about misconception here is that the absolute authority of Wali al-Faqih doesn't mean that he can run the state as he wishes. Wali al-Faqih is also restricted by law, and it is part of the constitution in Iran at the moment that the Wali al-Faqih also is the same as any other citizen before the law. Okay, so if the rulings are against the Islamic law, doesn't mean that he has the absolute authority. Absolute authority, as I defined it in the beginning, it means that his authority is extended to running a state. It's not limited to the matters of Umur al-Hisbiyyah and looking after orphans and widows and things like that only. No, he has further authority. This is one. And the second is that the absolute authority of a jurist neither elevates the status of a jurist to the level of ma'sumin, Because sometimes people, they think that, if he enjoys the same authority of Imam, then are you trying to tell me that Wali al-Faqih is ma'asum? No. Does not elevate his spiritual status to the level of ma'asumin, nor degrade the status of ma'asumin to that of a jurist. Like, what we mean is the following, in a simple language, that Imam al-Ma'asum, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would have the authority to lash someone who has committed adultery 100 lashes. The same applies to a qualified jurist. It's not that Imam al-Ma'asum, the Prophet, would give him 100 lashes and a jurist 60, 70, 50 lashes. This is what we mean about the authority that is absolute. Whatever authority in executing the Islamic laws a ma'asum has, a qualified jurist as his representative would have as well. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. All right. The second part of the topic for tonight, to cover it all up inshallah, is related to, an internal discussion. This discussion is about SLS versus AOLs. These are the abbreviations that I've made. All those who agree that yes, a Wali Faqih would have absolute authority, meaning that his authority is extended to that of running a state, there is a disagreement here. Majority, they go with SLS. SLS, it means system of single leader system. SLS stands for single leadership system. There is a minority that they believe in the second system, and that is system of AOLs. That means the system of A stands for assembly of leaders. They said that should not be a single leader, should be assembly of leaders. Now, that's what we want to examine, to see whether to run an Islamic state, is it better to have an assembly of leaders, shawr al-maraji, or we have a single marja running the state? Which one is more supported Islamically? One of the famous, supporters of AOLs, meaning that assembly of leaders, he, in one of his literatures, first, he starts with the idea that when we have more than one qualified jurist, meaning that potentially we have more than one Wali al-Faqih, the nation must have the option of choosing whether one of them or all of them as a council of fuqaha, council of Wali, or council of maraji to run the state. He says, إن تعدد الفقيه الجامع للشرائط فالأمة مخيرة في جعل شركاء في الحوك وانتخاب أيهم لتولي منصب الحوك فحال الحوك حال التقليد حيث يتخير العامي في تقليد جميعهم وأيهم شاء. The late Sayyid Muhammad Shirazi, rahmatullah alayh, that's what he says. He says that when there is more than one qualified jurist, people must have the option of choosing one of them or all of them as shawr al-maraji to run the state. We are not against establishing an Islamic state. We believe that the head should be the council of leaders. In his book, he presents 19 different reasons for that. Obviously, we can go through all of them, and really, with all respect, not all of them are really much relevant to prove what he's trying to say. Basically, he says that to run it in a council form is closer to the spirit of Islam, is more Islamic. And especially his main concern, that I want to concentrate more on that, his main concern is that a single leader system is more prone to autocracy and dictatorship. Whereas when you are running it as a council, it is less dictatorship. And therefore, because dictatorship must be avoided, therefore, not only we say that when there is more than one qualified marja, the nation must have the option of choosing one or or all of them. Here later on he concludes and he says, during the era of major occultation, like our present time, the head of the state must be a council. في حال غيبة الإمام عليه السلام كالحال الحاضر فرئاسة الدولة يجب أن تكون بالشورى. So later on he concludes that there has to be a council of leaders, not one single leaders, to avoid autocracy, to avoid dictatorship. Some humble comments that we have. First of all, as I said it about the previous discussion, let's say that that is the opinion of His Eminence, so be it, so be it. There are other maraji, and majority of our maraji, they believe in a single form, each to their own. Okay, but to say that to have a council of leaders is more Islamic, we say that shura, yes, definitely is more Islamic. But the concept of shura is different from council of leaders. The concept of shura and consultation, it means you are leading a company, all right? You're the director of a company, a sole director of a company, yet you have your own council of experts to discuss the matters with them. On finance, you have your financial advisor, your accountant gives you the financial advisor. On another area, you have your advisor and so forth. This is called the concept of shura in Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the battle of Uhud, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him wa shawirhum fil amr, he asked his distinguished companions about how we go about it, and what at the end of the day he made the decision. It was not a collective decision. He got the opinion from different companions, and at the end, as the leader, he made the final decision. Okay, so yes, we agree with the concept of counseling and a council, but that doesn't mean council of leaders. This is one. The second, the system of AOLs, assembly of leaders, has neither any specific textual evidence. There is no hadith to support this, nor can be supported by the practice of ma'sumin. Brothers, sisters, you find me an example that during the 4.5, almost 5 years of his leadership, Imam Ali alayhi salam appointed a council of governors for Egypt. Was it like this? Or he appointed one person only for Egypt? He did not appoint a council of leaders for Yemen, did not appoint council of leaders for Fars and so forth. Everywhere he was appointing someone, he was appointing only one person. And there is a wisdom in that, and soon inshallah I share it from the holy lips of an Imam al-Ma'soom, al-Imam Ali ibn Musa Rida alayhi salam. The hadith I'm quoting from Sheikh al-Saduq rahmatullah alayhi, in his isnad from Imam Rida alayhi salam, that in two books, his books is mentioning Ilal al-Shara'i and Uyun Akhbar al-Rida, that Imam Rida alayhi salam says, فَإِنْ قِيلَ فَلِمَ لَا يَجُوزْ أَنْ يَكُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِمَامًا فِي وَقْتٍ وَاحِدٍ. If somebody turns around and says that, why can't be in one time two leaders leading a nation, two leaders, two presidents, two imam, two wali faqih, you name it. And obviously, as you can see, the imam is not talking about Imam al-Ma'soom. In fact, even we had two Imam al-Ma'soom, Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein. And Imam Hussein, 10 years under the leadership of his brother Imam Hassan alayhi salam, was always under his leadership, whether on major issues of peace treaty with Muawiyah or trivial issues of giving a charity, was always working under the leadership of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam. But as you can see, Imam Rida does not limit it. He's not talking about ma'sumin, about non-ma'sumin even. Look at the analogy that he gives. The Imam says that cannot be two or more than two. Why? The Imam says that if somebody says why, I would say li'ilalin, for many reasons. Minha, one of them. أَنَّ الْوَاحِدْ لَا يَخْتَلِ فِعْلُهُ وَتَدْبِيرُهُ. One person makes one decision, and his decisions would not be different. There's no less confusion when one person makes a decision. وَالْإِثْنَيْنْ لَا يَتَّفِقْ فِعْلُهُمَا وَتَدْبِيرُهُمَا. Two people, their management will not be always the same. They won't always perceive matters in the same way. That's what I say, that the Imam is not apparently talking about ma'asumin, because for ma'asumin you can say yes, their management would be the same. The style of Imam Hussein, Imam Hassan, and all the Imams would be the same. Imam is talking about anyone who's leading the nation. Okay? And then the Imam says, وَذَلَكَ إِنَّا لَمْ نَجَدْ إِثْنَيْنِ إِلَّا مُخْتَلِفِ الْهِمَمِ وَالْإِرَادَةِ. We have never seen two people unless they view matters in a different way, with different, you know, approaches. فَإِذَا كَانَا إِثْنَيْنِ ثُمَّ اخْتَلَفَتْ هِمَمُهُمَا وَإِرَادَتُهُمَا وَكَانَا كِلَاهُمَا مُفْتَرَضُ الطَّاعَةِ. If you say that both of them must be obeyed, both of them have the authority, at least two or three or more, as Imam said. Now, and they have different approaches. The followers of this marja would like to follow Sayyid number A, for example. The followers of Sayyid B, they would like what their marja says. You see, an assembly of maraji end up in absolute chaotic situation and anarchy again in the nation. And the Imam says that because all of them are wajibu ta'a, because all of them supposedly have the authority, anyone who goes against anyone else, marja, has disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and therefore there will be corruption on earth. That's why it doesn't work. It's a matter of common sense, you see, that no nation, no country has more than one leader, because there's a common sense behind it. The concern that they had was about autocracy and dictatorship. Here is my comments on that. Number one, if you are concerned about dictatorship, as SLS, single leader system, is prone to dictatorship, likewise, council of leaders can all become dictators, put their heads together and become, council of dictators. That's also possible, number one. Number two, the authority of a jurist is by his qualifications. Don't forget that. The moment that a jurist becomes a dictator, he's automatically disqualified and no longer has any authority, whether it's one jurist or council of jurists. So this is not the issue really. If it happens, he is immediately disqualified. Article number 107 of this Iranian constitution reads, and I quote it to you, that the leader is the same as other citizens before the law. That's what I mentioned earlier. And the assembly of experts that we have, who are representative of the nation, they are overseeing what a Wali Faqih is doing. The moment they realize and they see that he's become a dictator, or as mentioned in the constitution, he's too old to run the nation and run the position, or they discovered from day one he was not a qualified Wali Faqih, they have the authority to dismiss him. So there is a council overseeing what Wali Faqih is doing on behalf of the nation in a very qualified, professional way. But at the same time, if single leader is prone to become a dictator, council also is not immune from that, can become a dictator as well. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.